right. Good morning, church. It's good to see each and every one of you here. If I would, Brother Seth, will you open us up in a word of prayer, please? Amen. All right, let's begin our worship service this morning. Let's stand and sing at Calvary.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me, he died on Calvary. To me, there my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned at Calvary. My burden soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love life on Calvary to save wretches like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. My Savior forever, he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Seated.
Morning. Good morning. It's good to see everybody today. Now, I got to tell off on myself. Now, many of you have noticed that I don't have the smallest ears in the world. And if you've seen me today, you're like, I think they've grown three sizes. No, they really haven't, but what happens when you grab your daughter's mask instead of your own? Boy, it just lays those suckers forward, and I look like Mickey Mouse. So if you get to staring later, I won't blame him, but if you want a selfie, that's going to cost you extra. But anyway, it's good to have everybody here this morning. I do want to remind you of some things that we got going on. Kiddos, what is it this week at school? You're like, I don't know. I'm not supposed to have to answer questions. It is spring break this week. And because it's spring break and because you have no school, we have a children's fun day planned this Wednesday. And so show up here at 1 o'clock. We've got some games and stuff planned for you. If the weather holds off and no rain that day, we'll let you go outside and we've got a bunch of activities there. But then about 5 o'clock, we've got pizza coming and you'll get to eat pizza, which I know none of the kids here like pizza. So we get to save all that for the adults. But at 5 o'clock, you'll have pizza and then we'll have church starting shortly after that. So parents, from 1 o'clock till 7:30-ish, you get to drop your kids off here and we will take care of them for you. So please take advantage of that. Give them something to do over spring break. If you have any questions of exactly what they're going to do or if there's anything that they need, see Kelly or Miss Becky and they can answer your questions for you. All right, kiddos, another one for you. Easter is coming up quickly. I guess it is this Friday night. We have an Easter egg hunt. And so this, huh? Okay, not this coming one, the one after. I'll get there. April 2nd, we have an Easter egg hunt, but this one's going to be a glow-in-the-dark Easter egg hunt. And I know I can see the look on some of the adults' faces. You've never done a glow-in-the-dark Easter egg hunt, and you kind of want to. I'll tell you what. If you come up here that night, we will rehide the eggs, and you can hunt them after the kids. But there's nothing in the eggs but a glow stick, so you're going to be disappointed if that's what you were hoping. But kiddos, 6 o'clock, April 2nd, we're going to meet up here. There's going to be some games. We're going to have some pizza for you again that night. But while you're doing all that, the eggs will be hidden out here. And at around 8 o'clock, we're going to turn you loose, and you get to go hunt all the eggs your little heart desires. And then you will leave here with a little goodie bag of candy. And so, church, this is where we need your help. You notice we have an Easter tree sitting out here right under by the Annie Armstrong offering. There's also a little purple box out there. That's where we're collecting this candy that we're going to bag up and give to each one of the children who comes on April 2nd. So if you would like to help us in that way, we would love all the candy you can bring. Now, I will tell you this. If you have some that you're a little questionable about, you know, if there's a chocolate that you go, I don't know if that's a good Easter candy, bring that to my office and I'll make the determination on that and then we'll go from there. But no, seriously, if you would like to help, that's out there. The children's department would love your help with that. All right, last week we announced that we've started making some summer plans. And one of those is that we're taking both our children and our youth to camp this summer. Our youth will be heading to Camp Siloam in Siloam Springs, Arkansas. And those dates are going to be July 12th through the 16th. Our children will be going to Wolf Creek, which is not too far away. And those dates will be June 21st through the 25th. I'll remind you that again because if you are a parent of a youth or a child and you have any interest whatsoever in going to camp, please stick around today after church. We're going to have a short interest meeting. I know you've got questions about what it's going to look like, how we're going to do all this. And so we're going to do our best to answer those for you today. I also have registration packets on hand. And I will tell you, I have a limited number because our printer ran out of toner this morning. Sunday morning problems. But anyway, stick around right after church this morning. We'll get those in your hands and we'll start making plans from there. All right, before we turn this over and do our Annie Armstrong announcement, are there any other announcements that we need to know about? It always makes me nervous when everybody looks around at other people like, are you going to say something? Are you got something? All right, Annie Armstrong, this is our offering for North American Missions, and we had set a goal for $1,000 this year, and I've got good news for you. We are halfway through the month of March, and we have already met our $1,000 goal. Now, some of you are like, well, dadgum, I was going to give. No, you're not off the hook yet. Just because we met the goal, if the Lord's still impressed upon you to be a part of this offering, please do so. There's still some envelopes in the chairs back there. There's some back on the tables. You can give in a lot of different ways, but just make sure it's marked in some way, shape, or form as Annie Armstrong. We'll make sure it gets to where it needs to go. But we're going to watch one more video here this morning. This is of a missionary, I believe, in Idaho. So part of our North American missions and directly funded by the Annie Armstrong Easter offering.
All of this story coming together just had God written all over it. Nampa First Southern Baptist Church was planted in the 50s. Some faithful folks were here saying we want to have a gospel-centered presence here. So this neighborhood, you know, kind of grew up around the church. And then the city grew beyond, and the church had to either adjust or not adjust to the changing environment around them. And so the folks that were left were the ones saying, how do you preach a resurrected Christ with a dying church? We heard about it, the plight of this church, and we packed it all up, me, my wife, my four kids, and headed for Idaho. Replanting takes the idea of church planting and puts it inside the housing of existing resources. We're planting not brand new in a brand new setting, but we're building upon the legacy of what was here. And so for us, preparing for a launch was a chance to kind of reintroduce ourselves to the community. We wanted to take full advantage of that. So it was flyers downtown, and it was mailers to the community, and it was getting out here to say this new church right here in this old context. And so, you know, when we launched in February of 2017, imagine a church that has been, you know, 30, 35 people maybe on a Sunday, to have 130 people show up in your sanctuary. I mean, those of us who'd been here through that process are looking around like, where'd these people come from? So does it matter that this church is still here and hasn't been given up on? Yeah, it does, because a watching community now knows, yes, Jesus is alive, because he can even resurrect a church from the edge of really closing its doors. So that's what we've been able to do because of the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. It's a gospel story baked into the story of this church and in our lives.
Amen. Amen. All right, let's continue our worship service this morning with a cling to the cross. I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. And with a thankful heart I come. I cling to the cross. I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. Without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come. I cling to the cross. Standing at an empty tomb, promises I have in you arise. I was made alive in you. Everything you said was true. You suffered, died, and rose to bring us alive. To bring us alive. I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. Without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come. Yes, with a thankful heart, I come. With a thankful heart, I come. And cling to the cross. Thank you.
behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
Let's all stand and sing that together.
The world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
Amen.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melody sonnet, sung my flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I fixed upon it, mouth of thy redeeming love. Yes, I was lost in utter darkness, till you came and rescued me. I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone. And come thou fount, come thou King, come thou precious Prince of Peace, hear your right to you we sing. Come thou fount of our blessings, and come thou fount, come thou King, come thou precious Prince of Peace, hear your right. Fount of our blessings. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. And come thy fountain, precious Prince of Peace. Hear your right to you we sing. Come thou fount of our blessings. Come thou fount, come thy King. Come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your right to you we sing. Come thou fount of our blessings. I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone.
Amen. Bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your day. Thank you for us being able to gather here together as one body and one church, one soul and mind under you, God, to praise and worship your name, Lord, in freedom. Lord, we thank you this morning for your worship. We hope it's pleasing to your ears, God. I hope we've lifted our voices and put a smile on your face this morning, God. Lord, I pray if there's anyone here lost today, I hope they come to know you. I hope they come to develop a personal relationship with you, to so you can walk by their side every day, Lord, and guide and direct them, Lord. Lord, be with Brother David and speak through his mouth, Lord, and put the words on our hearts this morning. Lord, I ask all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you, worship team. What a way to close this morning's worship out as we talk about the fact that we serve a God who can take even the worst heartaches and turn them into something beautiful. All right, we've got kiddos heading towards the back, and that's because Miss Kelly and Miss Becky are heading to Children's Church. So if you're second grade or below, they would love to have you this morning. Second grade or below, Miss Linda, that doesn't mean you. All right, for the rest of you, if you're stuck here with me, we're going to be in the book of 1 Samuel this morning. 1 Samuel chapter 7. Now, I just told you that we closed out singing about the fact that we serve a God who really can make something beautiful out of our messes. And if we're really honest, we've made a lot of messes before, haven't we? We've kind of messed up and failed a lot. And so kind of thinking about that, I want you to think back through history of people that you would say, oh, they were absolute and complete failures. People who've dropped the ball, maybe they just didn't do exactly what was expected of them. But we would look at them and we would deem them failures. Now, I don't know who all you've got popping in your mind who's going to make your list, but I guarantee you these people that I'm about to name did not make your list. First one I want to bring to mind, Albert Einstein. You're like, why in the world would you consider him a failure? I mean, this dude is like a world-renowned genius. He's known the world over for his theory of relativity. But did you know that it wasn't always that way? Albert Einstein wasn't always looked at as the genius that was. Albert Einstein, it took him till he was age 4 to start speaking, and age 7 before he could start reading. It was so bad that his parents and his teachers thought that he might be mentally handicapped. And now then, like I said, world-renowned for his theory of relativity. Abraham Lincoln, our 16th president, known as the Great Emancipator. People would go, oh, that's a pretty successful guy. I mean, we wouldn't think he's a failure, right? Well, did you know that Abraham Lincoln started numerous failed businesses, went bankrupt not once but twice, and lost 26 elections before he ever was elected to a public office? If we'd never heard the rest of the story, we'd say, yeah, he was a failure. But we don't. We don't say that because that's not how we know Abraham Lincoln. What about Walt Disney? Everybody knows Walt Disney, right? We love Walt Disney. We're going back to see his fun house again this spring. But Walt Disney was once considered a failure. He was fired as a cartoonist, of all things. And get the reasoning of why he was fired. He lacked imagination and good ideas. Walt Disney. And the rest of the story, I mean, it goes on. Walt Disney starts Walt Disney Company, creates Mickey Mouse, and everything that we see now. Walt Disney was once considered a failure. Now, we all know these people because of their successes, but they all experienced and shared defeat along the way. But there's one more historical figure that I want us to look at this morning. This is a guy named Douglas MacArthur. I don't know if we can really claim him as an Arkansan. He was born here, but we see Douglas here. He was a military brat, and that's why he was born in Little Rock. His dad was stationed here. But Douglas MacArthur was a five-star general of the Army. Very few men have ever made it to five stars general of the Army, but Douglas MacArthur was one of them. And Douglas MacArthur, from an early age, was successful. History tells that as he went through high school, straight-A student. Valedictorian of his class, Douglas MacArthur was the one that if they had the yearbook, he was going to be the one that was most likely to succeed. This was just who he was. He would later go on, after he graduates high school, he earns a commission to go to West Point. He enrolls there, and guess what? Finishes top of his class. But he doesn't just finish top of his class there in 1903. He scores so high, gets enough credits, that to this day, he is the third highest ranking member of any graduating class from West Point. This is a successful guy. He gets out and he goes into the Army and he serves his country valiantly. We know that on two different occasions before he turns age 40, he's nominated for the Medal of Honor. Before he turns 40, y'all know what I was doing before I was 40 years old? It wasn't getting the Medal of Honor. But says twice before he turns 40 years old, he is nominated for the Medal of Honor. He was a soldier's soldier. He was widely considered a military genius. He was brash and he was arrogant, but nobody could deny that the guy knew what he was talking about. Now, here's the thing. Did you know much of that about Douglas MacArthur? Probably not. Why? Because when we think of Douglas MacArthur, we think of this picture that's on the screen right now. We think of Douglas MacArthur wading back ashore in the Philippines. This moment of triumph. But do you remember what preceded that? World War II breaks out. Douglas MacArthur had retired from military service. But President Roosevelt calls him back to active duty and puts him in command there in the Philippines to head up his Southeast Asian group to ward off the Japanese advance. And it's there that in the Philippines that Douglas MacArthur is making his plans to withhold the Japanese, to wait until reinforcements could come. And he proposes this plan against the advice of all these other generals and admirals. Douglas MacArthur sticks with his own gut. And guess what happens? It ends in catastrophe. The Japanese come aground. They advance quickly. They very easily overrun the combined Philippine and American forces and push them inland, and it's all Douglas MacArthur's fault. He's the one who pushed this plan. He's the one who went against the advice of all these other high-ranking officials, and because of it now, they're stuck. And then, shortly after this happens, on March 12, 1942, Douglas MacArthur, his family, his staff, they all escape the Philippines by cover of darkness. And they flee to Australia. The Japanese army continues their advance, and it's not long before they completely, absolutely overwhelm, overrun, and wipe out the American and Philippine forces. And they take all of these soldiers as prisoners of war, and it becomes what we call the Bataan Death March. And in this Bataan Death March, there were 60 to 80,000 POWs. And eventually, roughly 30,000 of them would die because of the brutality of this Bataan Death March. And it's all because Douglas MacArthur failed. He failed. That's a pretty big failure. That's a pretty big weight to carry on your shoulders. And he knows it. When he gets to Australia, he makes this, he has this press conference, and he issues these words, "I will return." Douglas MacArthur makes a promise to the Philippine people. He makes a promise to his American troops who he had left behind. "I will return." And a short time later, on October 20th, 1944, we get this picture right here. Douglas MacArthur wading off of the boats through the shallow water onto the shore of the Philippines. He returns triumphantly. They push the Japanese out. They rewrite the story. And it's an amazing thing for Douglas MacArthur. The sight of his absolute biggest, most humiliating defeat is now immortalized as what? The sign of his biggest triumph. We remember Douglas MacArthur fondly. We remember him proudly because of this moment when he returns and they reconquer the Philippines. His biggest defeat turns into his biggest triumph. Now, wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be nice for us if our biggest failures, our biggest hurts, our biggest disappointments could somehow become symbols of triumph instead of defeat? Think about that for a second. Over the course of your life, we've had some failures. We've had some disappointments. We've had some hurts, and a lot of them have been pretty big. And in fact, we kind of define ourselves by those defeats. But what if those same events, instead of looking like defeats, became a way to say, "Look what God has done in me," and they become symbols of triumph, not failure? Well, folks, I want to tell you, I believe that we as believers can experience this. I believe that God is not just able to do so, but I think he longs to do so. I believe that we serve a God who desires to see our absolute worst experiences turned into something beautiful, because it shines light on him. Folks, this morning we're going to look at exactly how that can happen. We're going to look at a story in 1 Samuel 7 of how God did this for his people, the Israelites, who had absolutely royally blew it. They had absolutely, no doubt about it, failed. But God takes that failure and he does something amazing and turns it into something beautiful, to where it becomes a symbol of triumph and not defeat. So if you got your Bible, we're going to look in 1 Samuel 7. We're going to pick up here in verse 1. It says, "So the men of Kiriath-Jearim came and took up the ark of the Lord. They took it to Abinadab's house and on the hill and consecrated Eleazar, his son, to guard the ark of the Lord. It was a long time, 20 years in all, that the ark remained in Kiriath-Jearim, and all the people of Israel mourned and sought after the Lord. And Samuel said to the whole house of Israel, 'If you are returning to the Lord with all your hearts, then rid yourselves of the foreign gods and the Asherahs and commit yourselves to the Lord and serve him only. And he will deliver you out of the hands of the Philistines.' So the Israelites put away their Baals and their Asherahs and served the Lord only. Then Samuel said, 'Assemble all Israel at Mizpah, and I will intercede with the Lord for you.' When they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day they fasted, and there they confessed, 'We have sinned against the Lord.' And Samuel was leader of Israel at Mizpah. When the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. And when the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. They said to Samuel, 'Do not stop crying out to the Lord, our God, to rescue us from the hand of the Philistines.' Then Samuel took a suckling lamb and offered it up as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. He cried out to the Lord on Israel's behalf, answered him. While Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. But that day, the Lord thundered with loud thunder against the Philistines, and they were routed before the Israelites. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines, slaughtering them along the way to a point below Beth-Kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shin. He named it Ebenezer, saying, 'Thus far has the Lord helped us.' So the Philistines were subdued and did not invade Israelite territory again." Now we see here a story of a group of people, the Israelites, who they have failed. They have dropped the ball. They have ceased to be what they were called to be. They have not been doing what they were supposed to be doing. It was a failure in any way we want to look at it. When we first read in this passage, it says the ark was in Kiriath-Jearim. Well, there's a reason for that. You see, typically the ark had been in Shiloh. That's where Eli, the priest, was. That's where his sons were. That's where they attended to the ark. But something happened. There was this battle. There was this war. The Philistines had come in, and they conquered Shiloh and many other places like it and completely destroyed it. And so when they did that, guess what they took with them? The Ark of the Covenant. They took it, and we know, and not real quick, how many of y'all watched Raiders of the Lost Ark? Okay, if you watched Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know you're not supposed to touch the Ark of the Covenant, right? Because what happens? Your face melts off. Now, I don't know if that's biblical, but either way, the Bible is very clear. God had given them instructions that you're not supposed to mess with the Ark of the Covenant. Well, the Philistines took it, and guess what God did? He cursed the Philistines. They started breaking out in all these tumors and weird sicknesses to the point where they're like, fine, just take the thing back. And they put it on a cart, attached it to some oxen, and said, get out of here. Just go. Get away from us. And so the Ark of the Covenant comes back to the people of Israel. The Philistines let the Ark go, but they did not let the people of Israel go. They were still enslaving the people of Israel. They were still ruling over them. And it says the ark comes to Kiriath-Jearim there, and it stays there for 20 years. I want you to think about that. Here's something, the ark, it ought to be a symbol of hope for the people of Israel. It ought to be something they look at and go, man, God's good, he's with us. But every time they see it there in Kiriath-Jearim, guess what they're reminded of? It's not in Shiloh. And it's not in Shiloh because we failed. It's not in Shiloh because we didn't stand up to the Philistines. We didn't do what we were called to do. And we let them completely come in and wipe us out and take the ark. So every time they looked at it, all they saw was failure. They were reminded just how far that they had come and how deep their defeat was. Then we read over in verse 13, something miraculous happens. The people have come to Samuel and they said, we really do want to worship the Lord, and we only want to worship him. And the Lord hears them, and he takes their plea, and he acts on their behalf. And says the Philistines come to attack again. But this time what happens? Just the Lord throws them into confusion, and they are completely slaughtered. And not just slaughtered, but to the point that they never again enter into Israelite territory. They went from utter defeat to absolute triumph. And we're left with the question of how. How did this happen? How did the Israelites move from absolute 100% utter collapse and defeat to the biggest triumph you could ever imagine? How did they do that? I believe our text gives us some clues, and I think it's going to be the same thing for us. Because as I look around the room this morning, we all have faced those things, right? We've all had failures. We've all had defeats. And we go, Lord, if you could just make something good out of this, Lord, I would be eternally grateful. Well, guess what? He can. He will. He wants to. How does that happen? Well, let's look at the text and see what it tells us. The first thing that we got to do if we want to see defeat turned into triumph, we have to make a choice to seek God and not others. That's where it started for the Israelites. They weren't going to find the strength that they needed to deal with this. They weren't going to find the strength they needed by looking inward or turning to other gods. And trust me, they had tried. If you read through Scripture here, there's a pattern. Israel enters into a covenant relationship with the Lord. Israel gets a wandering eye. Israel starts flirting with some foreign gods. Israel turns full-fledged into foreign god worship. God turns his back on the Israelites. They get conquered. Israelites get sad. Repent, complete the cycle. We see over and over again where they've tried this right here, where they've looked to other people. They've looked to other gods to be for them what only Yahweh could be. Folks, we're the same way. You want to know why we face a lot of our defeats to begin with? Because we've looked to our strength or to the strength of others, when really the only strength that matters in us is the strength that God gives us. If we want to see our defeats turn into triumph, we have to understand that we've got to make this choice to seek God and not others. The Israelites made a choice to repent and seek God. What's that mean, to repent and seek God? Well, it's two parts. First thing I got to do if I want to repent is I have to turn from my path, the path that I am currently on. That was tough, isn't it? I kind of like my path. A lot of times, I pick this path. Heck, if we're being really honest, there's a lot of times I designed this path. But if I want to repent and turn back to God, I have to say, Lord, I'm willing to turn around and admit that I don't have it all together. There's a humility there. Humility is a characteristic that is in short supply in our world today. Nobody likes to admit that they don't have it together. Nobody likes to admit they don't have all the answers. Nobody likes to admit that maybe, just maybe, they might be wrong. Instead, what do? We get to say, well, everybody just gets to make up what's right for me. You know, that may be true for you, but for me, no. That's just our way of not being humble. It's just our way of saying, I'm not wrong, but neither are you. We're both right. Folks, it doesn't work that way. If I want to repent, I have to acknowledge before God that I don't know it all. There's times that I have made a huge mistake, royally, willingly made mistakes. I have to turn from my path and turn back to God. The picture that we get here is that for 20 years, the people of Israel have, every time they saw the Ark of the Covenant, been sad. They have cried tears as they look at the oppression all around them, that the Philistines have enslaved them. There are real tears being shed. But the tears are because of their circumstances. Folks, repentance means that I quit shedding tears over my circumstances and I start shedding tears over the sin that led to it. Quite simply, we get to the point that our sin bothers us again. We get to the point where we say, Lord, this isn't what you want for me, and I know I'm going against what you want, but no more. I'm turning my back on that, and I'm going a different direction. Repentance means I turn from the path that I'm on. But it's not just that I'm turning from the path that I'm on, it's that I'm turning to God alone. Notice what Samuel told the children of Israel here. Look with me in verse 2. It says, let me get on the right page. He tells them, says, and Samuel said to the whole house of Israel, if you are what? Returning to the Lord with all your heart, then rid yourselves of the foreign gods and the Asherahs and commit yourselves to love and serve him only. Notice Samuel didn't tell them, hey, if you're turning back to God, here's what I need you to do. I need you to send a telegram out to your closest allies and tell them that you're getting ready for a fight. He doesn't tell them, hey, if you're turning back to God, I need you to arrange all those idols in your house, clean them up, get them ready, because we're going to need their help too. What does Samuel tell them? If you really are serious about this, if you're really turning back to God with all your hearts, then get rid of everything else. We would say it like this. Quit hedging your bets. God is either all God or he's not God at all. Samuel told him, said, if you are really turning back to God, get rid of everything else. Quit looking to them for help and rely solely on God. Folks, that's biblical repentance. Biblical repentance isn't hedging my bet, you know, saving a little something over here in case God doesn't come through. No. Biblical repentance means I turn back to God, forsaking all others, because he is the only one who can take care of me. I'll give you a spoiler alert. If you keep reading through here, you're going to see that they didn't hold this advice. Samuel tells them to get rid of. What did they do? They put them away. I shoved them in a closet. You know, I don't want to get rid of these just yet. I might need them later. But at least for this moment, they said, God, you're who I'm turning to. You are the one who's worthy of my worship. And because that, God heard them. And folks, it's going to be the same way for us. If we ever want to see our defeats turn into something more than just defeat and failure, we have to turn back to God. We have to make this choice to seek Him and not others. But there's something else we have to do. We have to commit fully to God's plan. Look at verse 5. Then Samuel said, "Assemble all Israel at Mizpah, and I will intercede with the Lord for you." When they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day they fasted, and there they confessed, "We have sinned against the Lord." And Samuel was leader of Israel at Mizpah. If we want to see the Lord turn our defeats into triumphs, we have to commit fully to His plan. Now, if you're like me, there's a lot of times we're really good at saying the right thing. Oh, Lord, I trust you. Oh, Lord, I know that you got a plan, and Lord, I'm just letting you do your thing. That's what comes out of our mouth. But are there any actions to back that up? See, for 20 years, Israel was real good at the lip service. Lord, we're so sad here. Lord, we're so tired of the Philistines being mean to us. Lord, we're so sick of this. But nothing ever came of it. It wasn't until this day that Samuel says, look, if you're really serious, then get rid of that stuff and turn back to the Lord. And for the first time in 20 years, there was action to their words. Notice what it says here. It says, there was intercession. What's intercession? Prayer. They prayed before the Lord. They acknowledged God's supremacy. Lord, you're not just the top of the pedestal. Lord, you're just not on the top shelf with all these other gods. Lord, you are the only one on the shelf. You are supreme. You are the only one who can do for us what needs to be done. So as Samuel interceded for them, as they prayed, this is what they were doing. They're acknowledging God's supremacy. But it goes on, it says, they poured out water and they fasted. Like, oh, preacher, we are Baptist. We don't believe in that thing. I mean, we are like the church of potlucks here, so you don't be talking about fasting. Look, here's the point of fasting. It's not just so that you would go without food. When we fast, what we're doing is we are focusing on the Lord. We're focusing on what He wants to do in our lives and through our lives. And so when we see that the Israelites were fasting, it wasn't just they decided to go without a meal and go on this hunger strike. No, they were focusing on the Lord, and they were focusing on what His will was. And rightfully so. For 20 years, they hadn't heard it. For 20 years, they hadn't sought the Lord. For 20 years, they hadn't stopped to consider what He might want from them. But on this day, they fasted and they focused, seeking to see what the Lord's will was for their lives. And I think it's interesting that after they had fasted, after they focused on the Lord, what happened? They confessed. You know what happens when we get still enough to focus on God every once in a while? We realize just what kind of shape we're in. We realize just how badly we really do need Him. They just thought they needed Him before because the Philistines were being mean to Him. They just thought they needed Him before because they needed deliverance. But as they stopped and they focused on Him, they realized we need You because we are sinful to the core. Lord, we need You in more ways than we can count. And they started confessing before the Lord. Folks, when that happened, the Lord heard them. The Lord drew near to them, just like Scripture says He will. As I read that this week, man, it hit me like a ton of bricks. Because like many of you, I long to see God do something amazing through my past mistakes, through my past failures. I want Him to be made much of through them. But you know what? I wonder how many times I've missed God working in my defeats. Because I just wasn't willing to put action to my words. Well, I'd whine like the Israelites. I'd whine and complain that things weren't going my way. I'd whine and complain because circumstances were hard. But that was it. I never put action to my words. The Israelites here did. They prayed, they fasted, they confessed, and all of it led them to the feet of the Lord, and the Lord took them back. Leads us to the next thing we have to do. We have to absolutely commit fully to His plan. But let's be honest, sometimes that seems kind of foolish, doesn't it? I mean, if you just read Scripture at face value, think back to the story of Joshua. Remember that plan? All right, Joshua, here's what I want you to do when you go to Jericho. I want you to lead a parade around the city once a day for 6 days. Then on the seventh day, I want you to lead a parade around it seven times. And whoa, Joshua, hang on. When you get to the end of that seventh one, I want you to let the band start playing as loud as they can. Complete honesty here. If I'm Joshua that day, Lord, what's plan B? Because this one doesn't sound like it's real sound. We read through Scripture and we see stuff like this all the time. There's things that God tells His people to do that doesn't seem like it ought to work. But guess what? It always does. Because His ways aren't our ways. And so it's not just that we have to commit fully to His plan. When we do that, then number three, we must rest in God's provision. Believing that God can do what He said He's going to do. No matter how ridiculous the plan sounds to us, no matter how far-fetched it may seem to us, we just rest in God's provision, trusting that He can do what only He can do. In this story, what happened? The Philistines come calling. The Israelites start to panic. Oh, Samuel, please do not stop praying for us. This is not looking good. Did the Israelite army line up, flex their muscles, and send the Philistines running? No, what happened? God says, don't worry. You're mine. I've got you. And it says He thunders out and absolutely scares the Philistine army to death, throws them in complete disarray to the point that they don't know what's going on and they get absolutely slaughtered. Now, none of our military generals would come up with anything close to that. All right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to wait for the weather to hit, and that's going to scare them, and then we're going to attack. No, this was a God thing. But it shouldn't surprise us, and it shouldn't have surprised the Israelites. For generations, they'd grown up hearing the stories of Yahweh. They'd grown up hearing the stories of how He had delivered His people from Egypt. Remember that one? The plagues have come through. The tenth plague, the death of the firstborn hits. And Pharaoh finally relents and says, fine, get out of here. And as the Israelites are fleeing, Pharaoh comes to his senses and goes, I just let my entire workforce go. I need to go get them. What did he do? He parts the Red Sea. The Israelites start passing on dry ground. As the Egyptians follow around them, that last Israelite steps onto dry ground on the other side, and the waters collapse, destroying the Egyptian army. Well, that's cool enough. But God called a shot. God said He's going to do it. In Exodus 14, this is what He tells them. Says, the Egyptians that you see today, you will see no more. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. We see Him tell David the same thing in Psalm 46:10 when He says, be still and know that I'm the Lord. Folks, there's something that happens when we realize who we serve. When we realize how big of a God He is and that He has never yet failed to live up to His promises. He won't start now. You know why? Because He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The same God who took care of the Israelites when they faced the Egyptians. The same God that faced the Philistines here. The same God that took care of David and took care of so many others throughout history is the same God that's taking care of you and I today. We just got to stop, be still, and trust Him. Rest in the provision. See, God has promised to fight for His own. He's promised us that. When we align ourselves with God, we can be certain that He will fight for us. we start talking about trying to turn defeat into triumph, if we're really honest, there is not a single thing that you or I bring to the table that can make that happen. I don't care how hard you work at it. I don't care just how tirelessly you are. At the end of the day, you can't change what's happened. But God says, I can take that and mold it and morph it into something beautiful. Trust me. Trust me. The Israelite army, the Israelite people rested in God's provision, trusting that he's going to take care of them. And God came through. And that leads us to the last thing that I want us to see here. If you want to see defeat turned into triumph, we must be careful to mark God's victory. Not ours. It wasn't the Israelites' victory. God did this. And we have to be careful to mark God's victory. Look at verse 12. It says, then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shin, and he named it Ebenezer, saying, thus far has the Lord helped us. So the Philistines were subdued and did not invade Israelite territory again. See, when we realize who we serve, who we have given our lives to, it's not a if he will come through. It's not a if there's going to be a victory. It's a when and how the victory comes. What's it going to look like? God faithfully took care of the Israelites by fighting for them. Samuel understood that, and he wanted to make sure that the rest of the Israelites never forgot it. So what's he do? He says, boys, God really came through there. Boy, did he show out today. Okay, I don't want us to ever forget this moment right here. I don't want you to ever forget the excitement that you're feeling right now. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to go get some of those rocks right over there, and right here in the middle of the battlefield, we're going to build this monument. We're going to build this thing up, and every time we see it, we're going to go, whoo. Remember what God did that day? We're going to look at it, and we're going to see it. We're going to remember. And he says, but you know what? It needs a name. How about Ebenezer? What a weird name. I mean, let's be honest. When we think Ebenezer, we think Scrooge. And we're going, Ebenezer. Samuel, why in the world would you pick such an odd name? Well, if you flip back a few chapters to 1 Samuel chapter 4, you see that there's a battle that has taken place. That's where Eli and his sons and the rest of the Israelite army have lost the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines. And that battle took place at a city named Ebenezer. You see what Samuel did there? It was at the city of Ebenezer that the Israelites lost the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines. That name used to bring shame and guilt and a myriad of other negative feelings. Every time they heard the name Ebenezer, all they could think of was the fact, we lost it. We blew it. That's where it changed for us. Ebenezer used to be a sign of shame and guilt, but now they look at this marker that's set up right there in the middle of the battlefield, and it's named Ebenezer, and every time they hear that name now, they don't think about 20 years ago. They don't think about the time when they lost the ark. They think about the triumph that God did on their behalf. God had turned their biggest defeat into their biggest triumph. It says the Philistine army never again entered into Israelite territory. They were still around for a few more years. They were still making noise. Remember David and Goliath? Goliath was a Philistine. But they never again entered into Israelite territory. Never again did they enslave the Israelite people. And that marker was testament to it. That Ebenezer was testament to the fact that God had turned defeat into triumph. That day, God changed the Israelites' biggest defeat into a lasting sign of triumph. Folks, he can do the same thing for me and you. I don't care how big you think the defeat is. I don't care how overwhelming and complete you think it may be. It's not too big for God to make something beautiful out of it. I don't care how bad you think you have messed up or how often. It's not too much for God to make something beautiful out of it. Our God longs for and desires to turn our biggest defeats into something beautiful. But it's kind of up to us. Will we do like the Israelites did for those 20 years and moan and groan and just complain? Or will we do like they did on that day? Where they turned back to the Lord and said, Lord, we admit we made a mess. But God, we believe that you can clean it up and make something amazing out of it. This morning, are you willing to give God the things that have defined you for years? Those mistakes, those failures, those defeats? Are you willing to give them to him and say, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do it, but God, I trust that you can do something amazing through these. My prayer is that today is the day that our defeats turn into triumphs. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this morning, and Lord, you know that, Lord, my life is a long list of defeats and failures. Lord, you know there's a long list of things that I got more wrong than I got right. God, as we sit here this morning, many of us could testify to the fact that that's exactly how we see ourselves. Or if we're honest, we feel like that's how everybody else sees us too. As defeated, as failures. But Lord, this morning we're reminded that with you, we are never defeated. We are never failures. Because God, there's nothing so bad that you can't make something beautiful out of it. So Father, this morning I pray for myself. Lord, I pray for each and every person here, every person watching online. That God, if there's something we've been holding on to, letting it define us, God, today we would just give it up. Lord, we'd turn from that path, Lord, turn to you. Lord, let you do what only you can do. God, may today be the day that our biggest defeats. Lord, may it be the day that our biggest defeats turn into your biggest triumphs. Lord, this morning we just ask that you'd have your will and your way in each and every one of us. Lord, we love you and we come to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will ever love.
Folks, that's a song we all know and love and have sung hundreds of times. And it's an easy song to sing for us, but it's a hard one to put into practice, isn't it? But that's going to be the key. If you want to see God do something miraculous and amazing in your life, you got to surrender it all to Him. You can't hold anything back. We can't try and do it our own way. It's on His terms, and that's the way it ought to be. And so this week, that's my prayer, is that, Lord, I don't want to be defined by my failures. I don't want to be defined by my defeats. But Lord, as I surrender everything and give it back to You, do something miraculous with it. Lord, use it for Your glory. All right. Was there anything before we dismiss this morning? All right. Well, don't forget, parents, we will be having the camp interest meeting right up here. Just have a seat, and as soon as I get done shaking hands, hugging necks, or, well, I don't know, that's COVID stuff. I can't hug too many necks. I'll meet you up here, and then we'll go from there. So, all right, well, let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father God, we do thank You again for letting us be here this morning. Lord, I thank You for each and every person who's here. Lord, every person who's watching online. God, I just pray that You would continue to speak to us this week. Lord, I pray that we wouldn't let Satan convince us that our defeats define us. And Lord, because of that we are not fit for service. But Lord, I pray that You would remind us that You are bigger than anything that He could throw at us. You're bigger than anything that we have done that we consider failures. Lord, work in our lives, work through our lives, Lord, to reach other people. Lord, be with us now as we leave here. Lord, bring us back again safely. Lord, we love You and we come to You in Jesus' name. Amen.